A very good afternoon. I know that after the lunch and towards the end of the day, you are a little tired and want to relax. But we would like to share in an informal manner how we traveled this road and want to share all aspects of our success in this area. Educational psychology says that learning occurs as a result of interaction of the learner with the learning environment. And the achievement of each learner depends on how resourceful is this learning environment. So the big question is, whose responsibility is it to give, to provide such a physical, psychological, social, and emotional environment in which learning is conducive? This morning we heard that it is the duty of the teacher. Now we want to share our success story, and we believe that it is the collaboration of all stakeholders, students, parents, teachers, support staff, administrators, and all well-wishers of the institution. Then the next question is, how do we achieve it? As teachers, we are very familiar with the learning pyramid, and we know that inspirational talk, discussion, handouts will not have 100% impact in building habits. So what we do is teaching others personal interaction and immediate application is the road to success. So we make sure that each stakeholder has got a well-defined part for providing safe, healthy environment which is conducive and which can maximize learning. Today with me, there are three other members of the Indian school community. Mrs. Beena Gurudasani was our former student. Her two daughters were students of our school. Elder daughter passed grade 12 last year and is now pursuing higher studies in the United States. And she happened to be one among the 8 prestigious Sheikh Hamdan Award winners. Mrs. Gurudasani was associated with the Indian High School for quite some time in revamping the health and safety arrangements in the school. We will hear from ma'am. Along with ma'am, two of our students, Anamika and Taisin, both are grade 9 students, they will also tell us the role and responsibility of each student in developing as well as maintaining such an environment which is maximizing their learning. To start with, we will share in nutshell all programs that we are having in our school. And as we are watching this clip, whatever doubts you have, please make note of that. You will see a lot of programs coming up there also. And during the later part, we will explain that and clear your doubts. Thank you. Thank you. Now, a little background or theory. There cannot be a practice without theory. We are all familiar with the six areas of DSIB inspection, and area 5 is dedicated to health, safety and security. In 5.1, there are 5 key aspects, and if you look at them, none of them are standalone. For example, in providing adequate arrangements to ensure health and safety, we need to look at the child protection policy. We need to look at the healthy living style. So all these are put together in a nutshell, and we have formulated a 5-step procedure. Provision, policy, procedure and protocol. Intake from all stakeholders, parents, students, Dubai Municipality, Ministry of Health, KSDA. We read through all their pamphlets and formulates the policies regarding health and safety. Action plan and timeline. It is not a single event that happens at one point in time. We plan it early in the academic year, in fact, before the academic year starts, so that we have a roadmap on in which month what will happen. And implementation of different programs are at different stages. They are closely monitored and evaluated. These programs are audited internally and externally. To state, we are an ISO certified organization. For the last 12 years, we were having internal and external audit at least twice in each of the 26 departments by the Lloyd's Registry of UK. Now, talking about health and safety, we need to identify the personnel as well as the provisions that we are providing. You can see the various departments which are contributing towards that and the various facilities where we are covering this. Likewise, the programs and the personnel involved in health and safety and the different events that will take place throughout the year. Some are on day-to-day basis, some are bi-monthly, some are once in a term. Physical education is not something what happens during the physical education period. We will hear more about the programs under physical education, which is happening from the time they step into the school till they go back home. At this point, I will hand over to Mrs. Beena Gurudasani, who was an active member of the CEO's focus group. We have a parents focus group for each cohort or section. Like grades 5 and 6 will have a supervisor. There are about 22 to 25 divisions under her, and there will be one parent representative from each of these divisions. So each cohort will have about around 25. So between 8, 4 in boys section and 4 in girls section, that is 5 and 6 is one section, 7 and 8, 9 and 10 and 11 and 12. All together there will be around 200 parents in different under different supervisors. And from all these parent focus group, we will select CEO's focus group, which will contain about 20 parents. And these 20 parents are people who are having rich resources, and we keep them as our advisors. They may be working in the field of health and safety. They may be related to ICT, and some may be related to teaching and learning itself, not necessarily in our school, elsewhere. So we have such a strong focus group assisting and interacting continuously with the CEO.
The CEO's focus group does not start at that level. We first have the focus group at the supervisor level where we meet up, and since I have been in the focus group for 2 years, I have an idea as it becomes very important to have one-to-one conversation. In the morning we heard that whose responsibility it is, whether it is the parents or the teachers. Well, I believe, and at IHS also we believe, that it's both, because it's a second home, which means the first home, the mothers, the fathers, all are given opportunity. Any one parent can choose, even both the parents can come. and we discuss a lot of matters related to health, comfort, safety. I mean, the focus group can pick up any issues. It's a one-to-one conversation first at the supervisor level, and then we go on to the CEO's level, where we actually are given an opportunity to suggest, because sometimes suggestions from others are better, and we can incorporate a lot of ideas, because we grow up in different atmospheres, so our experiences are quite different. So that way we get the best practices involved. And we meet approximately 3 to 4 times in a year, so all the issues are sorted out, and new ideas are put into action. And the next one, we also have something very unique in our school is the CEO's think tank, which we proudly call it the voice of today and the vision for tomorrow, for the simple reason students are connected to each other more than they're connected to teachers. The first point of contact, whether it is the class monitors, the bus monitors, or the prefects, they know the issues of the children more than us. So among the group, we have a dedicated group, which is the think tank, which takes into all the issues with these children they're facing on one-to-one level. And the issues are then brought up along with the student council, which is again a big body of children, the sports faculty or any other, and they all devise a plan wherein suggestions are put. There are a lot of programs which we conduct over a period of year. One of the best programs which we started and is really implementation is, we call it the Canteen Movement Project. Now, all of you are aware that the canteen is a time, it's 15 minutes or 20 minutes break, where all the kids want to rush to the canteen and they want to meet their friends, and you can imagine the hush and bush and the injuries that could be a part of it. So we came up with this canteen project where we designed these lines. You can see the blue, yellow, red, they're dedicated lines where from the minute you enter the canteen, the line starts and it focuses on what you need to buy. You walk up to the line and you can step to the canteen bar where you can see the food only when it is clear. So there is a space and there is no hush and bush and no injuries. This is a successful project which has been very well implemented by the girls of the think tank. And it has, because we had some injuries, of course, we have to learn from mistakes, and this is what we have. This is one of the best projects. There are many more other projects that we have. So.
These are some other unique programs that we have in IHS. Some of them, like Round Square of Duke of Edinburgh program, are in some other schools also. But we have some in-house facilities and programs, like Green Patrol is a CLEP, but a group of students who will be taking care of the environmental aspects. We have Saturday CLEPs, where if they want to excel in any one sports item, and they will join these Saturday CLEPs, because during the other working days, they may not get 1.5 hours continuously to play, because that is what is needed in a football game. So we provide opportunity for all this, and the best is by interacting with society. We have students in the Round Square program going to India, and rural communities, they work for a week or two helping to make buildings. And last year before last, this was some classrooms. In 1 year, it was a computer lab, and sometimes it is the toilet facilities that our students were helping out in some rural areas. We have a partnership with the Pediatric Center. We have a buddy program. In all our celebrations, we make them to participate. Let it be the March Past on Republic Day or any other program, we always welcome them. So they also have a sense of belongingness.
A very good afternoon to one and all present here, all ladies and gentlemen. My name is Anamika Krishnakumar, and I'm here to speak on the safety and security aspect of IHS. The most distinguishing of all is the RFID punching system to ensure and monitor the entry and exit of all the students. An identity card is a mandatory proof for those who enter and exit the school premises. That includes ex-students, parents, visitors, school staff, etc. Another system that has been put into practice is the taking attendance system. Might seem to be very common, but that's not the case. There are assistants appointed whom we lovingly and respectfully call Didis, which in our language means elder sisters. They ensure the presence of all the 11th and 12th graders before they exit the school premises. Another unique system that has been put into practice is the yellow line system, strictly abided by the students of IHS, that adds on to their safety during the entry, exit and movement within the school campus. The endeavor to ensure optimum safety during the outbreak of a fire or natural calamity with our unique strategies is an ongoing process, and fortunately we've achieved the same through these years. There are three top points to look into under this topic. First, the readiness of the staff to take full responsibility in case of the outbreak of such misfortunes is a valuable point to look at. Second, a detailed fire exit plan is drawn up for the whole school and is displayed in every single classroom and all corridors. This gives us additional knowledge. Together with the stupendous fire drills conducted by our school at least once in a year. Third, there is a common assembly point, preferably our school lawn, where the IHS family gathers in case of the above mentioned catastrophe. Furthermore, one of the most substantial departments of our school, the Parent Communication Office, plays a very vital role in ensuring that the parents are given quick updates on what is happening within the school premises. It is the first contact point for the parents and provides instant communication on miscellaneous issues related to safety and security. Thank you. With this, and I conclude my speech and hand it over to Tezi and Hans.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Tezi and I will be speaking about physical education that we have in our school. Now, as sir said before, physical education is not plainly restricted to our physical education period. In fact, it has to be implemented in all stages of our school life. So one such program for us is the Early Blossoms program. Now, you see, there are some students who come to school earlier than that is required. For example, the children who travel via the Sharjah buses, and there are some parents who have to go to their workplaces a lot earlier than the children. So they are bound to drop their children to school earlier, perhaps by an hour or so. So in this 1 hour, our school tries to make maximum usage of their time. So that is what is known as the Early Blossoms program. During this program, what happens is that these children, they are escorted to our auditorium, where they take part in a number of quizzes, they read the newspaper, they solve puzzles, they sometimes watch informative videos and many other things that are very useful for them. Now, this program is always monitored and by specialized teachers and staff members, and they always keep a vigilant eye on the students and make sure that they are always in a safe and secure environment. So this program, it ensures maximum productive use of the children's time, and it is always in a safe and monitored environment. Next point, aerobics. Now, aerobics, okay, we can do it during our PE periods or during our games period, but this, in fact, it is done before our assemblies. Now, every morning before our assemblies, there are a group of students who lead us in our aerobics routine. Now, this aerobics routine, it is not based on any dance forms, so it can be easily followed by all the students. And if you see, this is precisely what most of us need at, like 7 o'clock in the morning. It helps us to, keep us on our toes, and it helps us to face the challenges of the day ahead. The importance of play in the children's development and in the children's well-being has become more important, at least now. And it has reached a national level where play is extremely important in children's life. Now, our school has introduced what is known as the free play. Now, there are around 10 free play that are situated in extremely strategic locations, and they are easily accessed by all the students and at all times. Now, this free play is always open and anyone can play. Now, you can see there are hopscotch, there is the monkey bars, monkey ladders, all the, games that are very well loved by all of us. Most of us have forgotten about such games. So these are simple games, but it helps us to utilize our time to the maximum, and it keeps us healthy, and it's always provides some sort of entertainment. At the same time, it takes in the health aspect also. Now I pass on to Bina ma'am, who will be continuing more about the health aspects of IHS. Thank you. Okay.
This is the medical department. I think we'll get back to it, sir.
I will just brief about that. General bearing disability, we are all familiar with the 15 classification of KSDA, the support that the school need to provide. And in that, GLD1 and GLD2 are the two areas of challenge. Children who are attention seeking, who cannot stay on the task, these children are counseled. We have 8 counselors located in different blocks. And the class teacher or the supervisor can recommend them. With the parents' cooperation, very soon, within 2 or 3 months, they can wean them from the bad habits and be able to make them focus on their task. And the second facility for GLD2, these are extreme cases where they cannot learn in the normal classroom. So what we do is, in the minor periods like arts, games, music, these children go to the special facility, learning center, where we have trained personnel who can deal with all sorts of learning difficulties, and we don't charge anything special, and we welcome such students. We never say no to any student because the child is having a learning difficulty, and we have this facility in all our 3 campuses, starting from KG up to grade 7, because beyond grade 7 we will not be able to give this kind of support. Even if we are supporting, the curriculum that we are following, that is the CBSE, has no provision other than extending their writing time by half an hour. So this facility of learning center stops at grade level 7, and we then direct them to the open schools.
Okay. Health aspect is the most important aspect in the child's life, because if he does not eat well, he's not going to learn well, because all the issues are going to cater up to him, because he will not be able to have a focus level, eyesight may go down, and if he has a wrong concepts of eating food, he may put on weight, which overall relates to him not getting educated. Now, school's main purpose is to teach. So what we started is we put in some changes in the canteen, and we got in the Rainbow Revolution. Now, we all are aware of the fact that if we eat a wide spectrum of color, which implies that eating colors from all aspects, like the red color fruits, yellows, greens, it automatically leads to a healthy lifestyle. So how do we tell our parents, educate them? So we brought in the orientation programs. We invite the children and the parents, and we educate them, at least for your breakfast. Easiest ways to pack a good lunch or a breakfast for a kid is, make sure to use the maximum number of colors. Weave it around them, make sure their boxes are attractive, so the kid feels like eating. Now, there are some families which may want that, I am working, today I don't have the time. Does she compromise on having them to eat a junk on that day? Well, we don't agree. So we brought in the revolution, which we call the Rainbow Revolution, where we changed the menu also in our canteen. We brought in nutritious foods, colorful, which brightens up the kid. And we also displayed colorful posters talking about the health aspect, so the kid can carry back the knowledge. And he can tell his mother, okay, fine, let's work around this plan and let's make our meals more better. So the collaboration between the child, the teacher, the school, everything worked together. So even if they come to the canteen, we have the nutritious food supply at all times. And trust me, we make it economical. We don't charge them heavy. So the foods that we have, the salad bar, and the sticks and everything is very economical. Even the normal foods which we have, we bought in changeovers. Like even if we are giving them parathas, which normally Indian people love eating, we change the filling. Sandwiches are made more wholesome by changing the bread. So within the idea, within the concept, because I cannot force my kid to eat something new. So keeping in mind the trends the kids are eating at home and in our culture, we bought in changes. We also encouraged our students to make in recipes, healthy recipes, and we display their work. And the names are focused in the end, where the kids can go to each other and pick up healthy habits from there. So we encourage the children to have an atmosphere of health all around them. So a canteen is fully colorful, with all the colors reflecting on them. Okay, we have this very unique program. We call it the Fortnite Delight. It's something for the students and by the students. The kids of 11th standard choose their subjects into different streams like science, commerce, and arts. Now we bring all the kids together. The kids of science with the home science background, their opportunity or their responsibility is to churn out recipes which are healthy aspect. Then we bring in our arts department, which makes the posters into the, and they incorporate all these recipes, and the advertising is done by the marketing students. Last but not the least, we also have a group of the accounts children. They maintain the cost, because we need to be very cost effective. We cannot let the cost run over, because health cannot be at cost, which I believe, and we everybody believe. Last but not the least, since it is a program for the students and by the students take over the responsibility of maintaining discipline and cleanliness. So this actually, whenever we keep, you can have this, I'll come back to the Arabic corner. Whenever we have these menus, you can see the menus are displayed here. The kids take over everything, and they are asked to monitor right from the cooking process up to the selling process, and all the money that comes in goes for a charity. So the end, we even teach them the social responsibility of giving back to the society. So we put them into the zone that whatever you learn in your systems, you can apply to your life, in real life, and you can carry back this message. We also have an Arabic corner. Now this was an idea which came up when we realized that our Arabic, spoken Arabic was going very low, and the KHDA reflected this. So we bought in a novel idea of having an Arabic corner wherein all the foods, all the conversation, the selling and the buying is done in Arabic. So the child is encouraged to speak in Arabic, and they're also, if they want to know the nutritive value, because it's all health food. So everything healthy, but if you communicate in Arabic, you are going to get an offer of buy one, get one free, which I guess it excites the kids, you know, because for them it's a benefit. At one side, we are becoming, making their Arabic strong, and the other side, we are making them more getting the offer of getting. So whatever the incentive, as long as the kids are learning in a safe atmosphere, in a healthy aspect, it worked for us. And our Arabic has improved, definitely. And again, the proceedings all go for a charity. Okay, awareness is the key to us for every learning. The kids need to be aware, like in the morning we heard it, we need to be aware of our surroundings. We need to be aware of what's happening, and we need to give back to the society. So our kids in awareness campaign of breast cancer awareness campaign is happening every year. It starts off in the month of October, and we start distributing ribbons, sessions are held, and we have started donating hair. It's not only children, teachers are also a part of the campaign, and all the hair is given for making wigs, and the wigs are given free of cost to all the cancer patients because during chemo they lose their hair. So actually we just bring back a smile on their faces by giving them, and anyway, a lot of young children, you will find that they just want to cut their hair. Suddenly at the age of 10th, when they're in 10th or 11th, they suddenly want to cut the traces. We educate them, give it for a cause. Let's spread awareness. And that way, a lot of students of IHS have done it. And the campaign is still running. It's an all-round year campaign. We have months fixed where we can donate hairs. We also have the Duke of Edinburgh, the club, which actually does a lot of activities where they cook food, which is again healthy aspect. Again, this, they are educating the younger children. These are the 11th and 12th, 11th girls. They go and sell the food to the younger children, teach them the nutritious aspect of the food. And again, we believe in giving to charity. So all the money, every program of cooking which we are teaching our kids, the money is all gone to the kids. It does not restrict to the 11th and 12th grade students. Our awareness campaigns are even restricted, I mean, to these young kids who went about spreading awareness about no smoking. So we encourage a lot of activities. We believe that if he starts here, he's going to go a long way in spreading awareness. We also send our kids for a lot of activities which happen. This is an event which is happening by the municipality in the Dubai Mall, where they were again educating the audience, the people who came for the health. Eating healthy was the concept of this year. Every year it is different. So we strongly believe that health is an aspect, and if we give them a good way, a good healthy lifestyle, we are going to have better children and better learners out there. I think that's it. Thank you very much. Any questions? You can ask.
Yes. Presentation is very good. I think we child protection are related to the child abuse. How you are tackling this sort of issues in your school?
I told you that we have a parent communication office, which many other schools do not have. This is a 24/7 working office. We have two dedicated PCOs, parent communication offices. You can be in touch with supervisor, teacher, principal, or CEO through email, through SMS, through telephone. So if bullying has taken place, so there is a chance for that to happen even. The bus conductor or the driver can alert. It is the duty of the PCO then to contact all calls. The contact point for all such events is parent communication office. So the moment the complaint is lodged, the parents are contacted, the supervisor is contacted, a meeting is held in PCO in confidence. If there is if it is reported for the second time, then they are guided to the counseling center where the second set meeting is taking place under the supervision of the counseling center. If a third chance, if this is occurring, it is brought to the notice of ASDA and a warning is given, there will be temporary suspension for the students. Once we have laid out this policy, and it's available on our website, absence policy, child protection policy, it is zero bullying. In case, if the case is repeated, even for the first time, there are instances.
Everybody, we cannot achieve this zero bullying status, but yes. Anyhow, we have to struggle for this.
The thing is that before the child, if it happens in the bus, before the child reaches home, already there is a message for the father and the mother, and they welcome the child. And you know, for 11th and 12th, if a student is absent, the class starts by 7:10, by 8:10 they get a message saying that your child has not reached. So day-to-day base, we send SMS. And same thing, if the child has to stay back also from our side, we will make sure that the parents have been contacted and we have the permission for the child to stay back. These two girls who were the part of this program, one on a sudden we picked them the other day. First thing was for them to go to the PC office, call their parents, get the permission and blessing, and show the evidence for that, so that they could be a part of the community. So PCO largely helps out all this, because if this goes to teachers or supervisors, a lot of time in getting the correct person. The PCOs try from morning to evening and they can definitely get out of the list of concern.
Sir, can I add on something to
it?
No, I'll just add on. The think tank that I talked about is a group of people who actually had one program on anti-bullying schemes. And the groups, they came up with a video and talks and skits and all that. And the skits were conducted in the awareness campaign all over the school campuses. So every kid was alerted what on their front they can take. So the exchange was going on because these kids. Yeah.
One last question. How you are dealing with obesity in the students?
Yeah.
Related to the canteen management?
Yeah.
Dealing with parents?
Yeah, we have a parent session.
Programs.
Yeah, we work at the parent level, the teacher level, student level, and we have the canteen changeover. We cannot take out the normal food of a kid. Any person, if I ask you to eat a different cuisine, you will not enjoy. You will come back to your routine. So within the aspect of what is the normal food a kid is eating, we study the pattern and we bring in changes in that. A simple example is, in terms of carbohydrates and protein metabolism, we say if the breakfast is a balance of both, it is a better for the kid because the brain works faster. Because any sugar foods, the energy level shoots up, comes down. So what we do is every snack that we have has a 50% of protein and this. And we educate our kids on that. We tell the parents, we educate the students, so that at home the tussle is handled. So the parents are told to involve the kids in the tiffin preparation, and the kids are educated, please help a mother.
And what about the playgrounds? Is there any particular policy for obese students with, physical activities related to the physical activities? PE teachers, they are doing some special...
We monitor them, basically we find out the obesity level and they send me the details and we monitor I do the health aspect of it. We bring in at least 3 changes in a month because I cannot expect a kid to change in a matter of days. So we have to educate the parent and the
a month for the pattern to set. And trust me, if you give them logical connections of why to eat healthy, they don't go back to the system. So education is important. Just telling them eat this doesn't work. Telling them why they should eat matters. That is why if you come to our canteen anytime, wherever you look, there are recipes, there are banners, because we want the kids to set and ask questions. Even the weekend and all, you can ask questions.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much once again. Thank you.